Hello students, today I am starting with class 11s. I'll start with the very first chapter, some basic concepts of chemistry. This chapter basically begins with the units, the physical quantities, the conversions, the significant figures, decimal places, all these which are required for your numericals which are present at the end of the chapter. Okay, and I will teach these portions before teaching the numericals. Today I'll start with an important portion, which are the laws of chemical combination. The first law is the law of conservation of mass. Let's start with the first law. This law states that during a physical or a chemical change, the total mass of reactants will be equal to the total mass of products. If we consider a reaction such that the two reactants A and B combine to give two products C and D. If we measure the masses of the two reactants and if we measure the masses of the products at the end of the reaction, then we will see that the total mass of A and B will be equal to the total mass of C and D. This proves the law of conservation of mass. If I take an example, like if in a conical flask we take an aqueous solution of sodium chloride, and in another conical flask if we take an aqueous solution of silver nitrate, then before mixing the two reactants we will have to first measure the total mass of these two conical flasks containing the reactants. Then what we will do, we will just add AgNO3 to NaCl, or add NaCl solution to AgNO3, and both are correct. On doing this, we will see that on mixing the reactants, one flask will be empty and the other flask will contain the products. The products are the Cardi white precipitate of AgCl and the solution of NaNO3. After the reaction, if we measure these two conical flasks again, if we measure the masses of these two conical flasks again, we will see that the total mass will be equal to the initial mass that was measured. The reaction is like this. The reaction will be like this. NaCl plus AgNO3 will give Cardi white precipitate of AgCl and NaNO3. Okay, now one thing is important, that the law of conservation of mass is modified. According to Einstein's theory of relativity, mass and energy are interconvertible. From the Einstein's equation, E is equal to mc square, where c is the velocity of light, m is the mass, and E is the energy. From here, if we put the mass of any reactants or products or any body, we will get the energy released. So energy and mass are interconvertible from Einstein's theory of relativity. Okay. Now, in ordinary reactions such as, let me take an example of N2 plus 3H2 will give ammonia plus heat. Okay. ammonia plus heat. In this type of reaction, some amount of energy is released. You will notice that in this type of reaction, the total mass of reactants and the total mass of product will not be equal. There will be a change in the mass. This is because of the energy that was released in the reaction. But in this type of ordinary reactions, the amount of energy released is very small, or you can say that it's almost negligible. As a result, the change in mass is not that significant. So in ordinary reactions like this, the law of conservation of mass holds true. But in nuclear reactions, in case of nuclear reactions, in case of nuclear reactions, tremendous amount of energy is released. As a result, there is a significant change in mass. In these cases, the law of conservation of mass does not hold true. As a result, in this, there is a modification of this law of conservation of mass. The modified form is the law of conservation of mass energy, which states that the total mass of reactants or the total mass of the substances which are reacted will be equal to the total mass of products and energy. The mass plus energy has to be constant in this case. Hence, the law of conservation of mass is modified into law of conservation of mass energy. Okay? This is all about the law of conservation of mass. Next, I'll come to the law of constant proportion or the law of definite proportion. Law of constant proportion or definite proportion. It states that a pure chemical compound, a pure chemical compound always consists of the same elements combined together in the same definite proportion by mass. Okay, the law of constant proportion states that a pure compound, any pure compound, will always consist of the same elements. The source of the elements can be anything. The source of the elements can be natural, or the elements can be chemically prepared also. That is not a problem. The source can be anything, but it will consist of the same elements, and the elements has to be combined in the same proportion by mass. Okay, now let me explain to you by considering that a compound XY has to be prepared. Let us consider that a compound XY has to be prepared by two different methods. In the first method, P gram of X combines with Q gram of Y, and in the second method, A gram of X combines with b gram of y. It is noticed that by according to this law, the ratio of the masses of x and y and here ratio of the masses of x and y will be a is to b. According to this law of constant proportion, p is to q will be equals to a is to b. Okay, this is basically the explanation of this law with the help of an example. And if we take an example of water, we will notice that water consists of pure water. Pure water you can obtain from lakes, rivers, or if you chemically prepare pure water. It is seen that pure water will consist of hydrogen and oxygen in the ratio 1:8 by mass. Now why 1:8? Hydrogen has an atomic weight of 1, and here there are in water there are 2 hydrogens, so 2 × 1, which is 2. Oxygen has an atomic weight of 16. In water there is 1 oxygen atom, so 16. The ratio of hydrogen is to oxygen in water is equal to 2:16, 2/16, 1/8, which is equal to 1:8 by mass. Okay, now I'll come to the converse of this law. The converse of this law states that if two elements combine in a definite proportion by mass, they will always give the same compound. This is the reverse or the converse of this above law. But the converse of this above law is not always true. I will give you an example of this, that the converse of this law is not always true. This mainly happens for isomeric compounds. In isomeric compounds, the chemical formula is same for both the compounds, but the compounds are two different compounds with different properties. For example, in ethanol, and in dimethyl ether, in both of these compounds, carbon, hydrogen and oxygen combine in the ratio of 12:3:8 by mass. But both these compounds are prepared by two different experimental conditions, and both these compounds have different, completely different properties. Okay, so the converse is not always true. Okay, and there are limitations of this law also. What are the limitations? The first limitation is isotopes. Now what happens here? Carbon has 3 isotopes, 12C, 13C, 14C. In carbon dioxide,
if 12, yeah, if the isotope of carbon which has the atomic weight of 12 is used, then the ratio of carbon is to oxygen will be 12:32. If 13 C is used, then the ratio will be 13:32. If 14 C is used, then the ratio will be 14:32. The elements in carbon dioxide are only carbon and oxygen. The elements are same, but the problem arises is that the proportion is not the same definite proportion. The ratio of the masses differs in all the three isotopes, because isotopes are those elements which have the different atomic weight. So the atomic weights differ, as a result of which the ratio of masses in these three isotopes are not same. Okay, and the second limitation is there are certain compounds having variable molecular proportion. Variable molecular composition. It's not proportion, it's composition. Variable molecular composition. Copper sulfide formula, cuprous sulfide actually, copper 1, can vary from this to this. Also, titanium oxide have the same type of different molecular composition. Okay, in this type of compounds are known as non-stoichiometric compounds. For this type of compounds also, the law of constant proportion is not applicable, because constantly the proportion changes. Okay, the next is the law of multiple proportion. This was the law of constant proportion, and the next will be the law of multiple proportion. Okay, the law of multiple proportion states that when two elements combine with each other to form two or more compounds, then the different masses of one of the elements which combine with a fixed mass of the other bear a simple whole number ratio. I will explain this to you. What is a simple whole number ratio? Like 1:2, 3:5. These all are simple whole number ratio, which means that there will be no fractions in the ratio, there will be no decimals. These are known as simple whole number ratio. Now what happens here is that if I will just explain this to you by taking an example only. Let's take three compounds. Ethane, ethene and ethyne. In these three compounds, atomic weight of carbon is 12. 2 carbon means 12:2, 24. In all this, and the atomic weight of hydrogen is 1. If there are 6 hydrogens present, then 1:6. If 4, 1:4. If 5, sorry, this is not 5. Oh, very sorry, I made a silly mistake here. 2, then it is 2:1, 2. Okay, here 24 parts by mass of carbon combines with 6 parts by mass of hydrogen. Here 24 parts by mass of carbon combines with 4 parts by mass of hydrogen. Here 24 parts by mass of carbon combines with 2 parts by mass of hydrogen. Okay, so for a fixed mass of carbon, which is 25 parts by mass, for a fixed mass of carbon, the ratio of the hydrogens, the ratio of the masses of the hydrogens in the three compounds is 6:4:3:2. The masses of hydrogen in these three compounds, the ratio of the masses of hydrogen in these three compounds is 6:4:2, which will bear 3:2:1. This is the simple whole number ratio. Simple whole number ratio. Okay. Here also, in this law also, there is exception. If we take the compounds like methane, ethane, propane, and butane. For 12 part by mass of carbon, it is noticed that the ratio of the different masses of the hydrogen in different compounds will be 4:3:2:2.65:2.5, which means that this is not a simple whole number ratio. It includes decimals here. So in this type of cases, the law of multiple proportion is not applicable. Okay, this is more or less about these three laws. In the next video, I'll continue with the Gay-Lussac's law and then the John Dalton's theory. Okay, thank you.